While most people live their ordinary lives, the gods have made different plans for me, Bart Koppens. The gods have assigned me to be a keeper of their most sacred creatures. I am, indeed, a servant of the most noble creatures on planet Earth. The gods have forced me to become a keeper of moths. And today, I shall present you with one of the most sacred. It is called the Forsaken, or the Relict, Katokala Relicta, or also known as the White Underwing. Let me present to you one of the Earth's most cursed yet holy creatures. The gods influence us in many interesting ways. And while the gods have assigned most people an ordinary life, for me, the gods have a different plan in mind. For they have assigned me the noble and holy pursuit of being a creature, a keeper of some of their holiest and most sacred creatures, moths. Indeed, it is the plan of the gods for me to become a keeper of their most precious beasts, their most sacred. It is the will of the gods, and today I shall present to you one of the holiest, one of the most sacred. It is known as the Relict, the Forsaken, or the White Underwing, Katokala Relicta. Let me show you. The Forsaken is what they call this one, or the Relict, but others know it as the White Underwing, a beautiful black and white gothic looking moth species from North America. Let me tell you more about this really cool and dark insect. Ladies and gentlemen, here it is. This large white moth here on my hand is known as the Forsaken, or the Relict, or the White Underwing. Admire its glory, silly mortals. Admire its holy presence while it's feeding from this cloth dipped in honey water. These precious creatures, these sacred creatures that I take care of, that I am indeed predestined to take care of for the rest of my life. Admire them. Do you want to join our cult? The cult of moth, the cult of biodiversity? Then you better watch this episode, because I'm going to explain to you now how to breed these animals, the White Underwing. Let's start the holy intro of Moth Cycles. are the eggs of a really gothic looking moth, the white underwing. It lives in southern Canada and the United States, from Newfoundland to Vancouver Island, south to Missouri and Arizona. Like almost every species of Catocala, the eggs must hibernate before hatching into adorable little babies. Now the babies of this species can run very fast. Catocala caterpillars are highly mobile and fast, so be careful. Don't let them escape. The best is to scoop them up using a paintbrush and then gently transfer them into their new enclosure. This is their enclosure, a small insect pop-up cage, and in the middle there is an empty soda can filled with tap water. The water will hydrate the plants and keep them fresh, kind of like flowers in a vase. The plants are a selection of birch tree, willow, poplar tree and other plants that underwings love. Breeding underwing moths, by the way, is extremely different from breeding silk moths and their relatives. So prepare for seeing something that is totally new to my channel. The babies can be quite restless and spend a lot of time wandering aimlessly, looking for the best leaves to settle down upon and start feasting. This caterpillar already started eating. Wow, it looks like they prefer the leaves of poplar tree in this case, so from now on I will mainly be feeding them poplar tree. You can see it has actually chewed a hole in the leaf. If they are stressed, they can drop themselves dangling by a tiny string of silk. Most of the time, the caterpillars compress themselves against the leaf surface and don't move much in an attempt to conceal themselves. But when touched, they will quickly start running away from the perceived threat. Some of these are already instar number 2. They really do grow fast. Look at our beautiful babies eating right now. I am a proud father. It's funny, a lot of people, they ask me on my channel, Bart, can you breed Arabid moths? Now I mean like the true Arabid moths. I'll be honest, a lot of them are more difficult than stuff like Saturnid silk moths. But if you understand how, they're perfectly breedable. And I think these underwing moths will demonstrate as well, if I don't mess it up. Wow, so big. I'm excited, guys. This is my first official Catocala life cycle. If my fans enjoy this, I will make more of them for you in the future. And this appears to be instar number 3. The first instars of Catocala usually grow fast. In 2 weeks' time, they grow from instar 1 to late instar 3. By the way, if the leaves look wet, that's because poplar tree leaves secrete a thick, sticky and sugary secretion, especially when the leaves are young. Thankfully, it didn't seem to bother the caterpillars too much. Instar number 3 didn't last very long either. This is exciting because they seem to be growing very well and I wanted to make a Katukala life cycle for years now. But these episodes are very time consuming, so my time and resources are limited. I can only film a few episodes of this per year. Alright, people, see how the Katukalas are doing. There you go. Oh, geez. I see a lot of life in here, people. I wonder why some caterpillars are sitting on the old leaf, despite the fact they have fresh leaf available. Like, this is dry and old. Hello? Where are you sitting in it? Why are you sitting in dry and old leaf? Oh, I understand. You're trying to shed your skin. Now that makes more sense. They're not eating. That's an interesting observation. And if we look at the other leaves here, there's so many caterpillars. Like, can you see them? They're like crawling all over the place, so many of them. Funny is that rabbit caterpillars, they kind of, the way they move, it reminds us of loopers. Loopers often refers to the moths in the family of the Geometridae, geometrid moths, but they are not. So it's a different family. I guess it's just a superficial similarity. It's just a similar way of doing locomotion. But if we here look in the leaves, you can see like here, very well camouflaged, there you go. Hey you, yes. Can I see it? I don't know, it's probably a bit hard to see. Can you see them walking? They're so all over the place. And if we, I don't know how many there are, but this is actually a deep cage, it goes very further. So if you look at the leaves in the back, like, I bet that they're absolutely full of caterpillars. Let's see if I can show this. Can we look inside the leaf? And I mean, there's, okay, see? There's plenty of life in here. Like, there's even a small caterpillar here on my thumb. I don't know how many I have, it's impossible to count them at this point. My estimation would be there's like, I think like 40 of them, or between 20 and 40, I guess. Something like that number. Some caterpillars are getting quite beautiful now, with very nice color patterns. This is Instar number 4. This Instar is easy to recognize for its rather detailed and distinct camouflage. At this stage in life, however, they were becoming too big for their small enclosure, so I had to upgrade them. Let's check back later. Slowly but surely my babies are growing up now. Important is to change their food so the plant stays fresh, every 3 to 5 days. As always, what is kind of interesting is the size difference between big and small. Use one of the bigger caterpillars. Very camouflaged, pressed tightly against the tree trunk. In the wild, it would be very hard to spot this dude. But this is captivity. Hey. Yep, crawl away. Ladies and gentlemen. Hey! Are you one of the people that ever contributed to my channel? Because I just bought a fresh new cage here. Yep. It's thanks to the people who donate to my channel. I can afford stuff like this whenever I need it. And that keeps the show going. I say that a lot, but I have to give the reminder a lot. It's like commercials, I know. They're a little bit annoying reminders. But necessary reminders that you're allowed to feel good about yourself. So here I have some poplar tree leaves. They're not as poplar as I am, but it comes close. It's populous. And today I'm going to move our underwing caterpillars into the big cage. It's that moment that we all know, where we take the tiny cage. Here's the rest of the caterpillars. I'm going to upgrade their home. See the difference? Big difference, huh? Guess I'll just literally empty the contents of this cage in this one. Well, there you go. There you go. For the rest, I guess we will check back later. First thing that's important is that they start feeding. Wow, now Instar 4 is growing to a respectable size. I wonder what the final Instar looks like. Sub lads. We're a week later. Let's check back on the progress. Guys, I cannot help but notice many of the caterpillars are reaching very respectable sizes. This is about the maximum size for them, to be honest. I don't think they're gonna get bigger. This is soon to be pupa size. Very nice, people, very good. Take a look, people. Some of my larvae are on the stick. It's all one big happy family, is it not? It's all one big happy family. The Bart Koppens moth family. Now, as you can see, these larvae are beautiful and very well camouflaged here on a stick. I love underwing moths and their caterpillars, it's no lie. They are really gorgeous and underrated animals who should be studied more. Look at them here bunching up, trying to camouflage. Nah, just kidding. This is only a small percentage of them, I have way more. But the result... it's looking pretty great, don't you guys agree? It is looking really great. Wow! Wow! Alright guys, can you see the caterpillar here and the way it sticks against these branches? That's insane! And this explains why underwing moths, the caterpillars, are rarely found in the wild. You have to be really lucky to find one. Usually the only moment people see them is when they start to pupate, and that's when they walk away from the host plant sometimes. Other than that, their absolutely extraordinary camouflage makes it very hard to identify them. Like, it almost melts into this piece of branch. Very great. As you can see, the caterpillar is actually quite big at this point. It's actually not fully grown by far, but it's getting there. And I want to say, for the past few years, my channel has been like, oh, Saturnid, 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 Saturnid. Emperor moths or Saturnid moths are amazing. They are still one of my favorites. But I kind of want to change how my channel is only Saturnid central. And this is a part of my effort to bring a bigger, more beautiful diversity of insects to my channel. And underwing moths are actually very cool, underrated animals. I wish more people studied them and their life cycles. The amount of species there are on this planet is amazing. There's like 300 species of these guys, and they all have different colors. And here we see a young caterpillar. As you can see, there's massive age differences in my breeding, because some of the eggs of this species, they hatch way later than the early eggs. So you have like, this could be like 3 weeks age difference. It's really pretty cool. These species are absolutely gorgeous. Just look at that. Whoop. Wow. The white underwing from Canada and North America. Really a special species to have on my channel. Really special. All right, you go, my friend. Super. Ah, there it is. Trying to blend into the environment. Amazing. This is pretty much the final instar. The caterpillars are almost fully grown, and soon they will be ready to pupate. The caterpillars of Katokala are pretty awesome, and they have super camouflage. They often look like tree barks or sticks, and when pressed flat against the surface of a plant, they can blend perfectly in the vegetation. Katokala species are very fascinating, and not many people understand how to breed them. Sadly, they are not very popular in the hobby in captivity compared to other types of moths, which is a shame because there are hundreds of species of them in many colors and shapes. However, breeding Katokala moths is a special talent. Even if you are very experienced at breeding silk moths, it is possible that you will fail to breed Katokala. The breeding game is totally different than with other moths like silk moths. They need a lot of ventilation and space, but especially the adult moths need special care too. This particular species can eat a lot of plants, including birch tree, hickory, oak tree, and willow. But in this instance, they preferred poplar tree by far. However, people, here is the best news of all. Can you see that? It's building a cocoon. That's right. This is silk. And this is a caterpillar who wants to cocoon. But if we turn here over the leaf, don't know if you can see it, here we see another cocoon. Yay! The first moths are coming soon, people. This is amazing news. We did it. We raised the white underwing moth together on YouTube. A proud moment and a beautiful species. Let's leave it alone until it pupates. If the caterpillars feel threatened, they drop themselves to the ground and twist and turn rapidly. This is a defensive reaction that is normal for this species. A lot of other Catocala species do the same thing. Alright people, so if I look here in the branches of the host plant, I see way more of them. More amazing white underwings. The size is pretty respectable. They're going to be big moths, so I expect them to grow a little bit more. This is really great. Amazing. Wow, what is this? It looks like a cocoon, finally. Most of the cocoons are actually in the leaf litter on the floor, so we have to be careful. See, if we remove it, we see here silken constructions. And these contain pupating Catocalas. Now they're in the process of pupating, so I'm not going to remove them from the cocoons because that may disturb the process. But it is a good idea to get them out of here if possible. Let me see. Ah yes, if we look inside the leaf litter, lots of cocoons inside of it. Now, let's place the cocoons and pupating caterpillars together in a plastic container with a layer of soft paper tissue and check back in about 2 weeks when they will have pupated. And then we will collect our first pupa. Alright, let's see if we can open them up. Aha! Inside, what is it that we see? A pupa! A healthy pupa of Catocala. Hope you guys can see it. Pupa are very waxy. They have this interesting white layer of powder. A lot of arabids have this. I'm just gonna take the pupa out of their cocoons in this case. See if I can place the pupa here on the left. There you go. Just be really careful because not all of them may have pupated yet. But these pupate really fast. That's the good news. There you go. There you go. And another one. And another one. Hey, what's up everyone? This is not even half of them because we still have many caterpillars that are not even cocooning. And this is just the first harvest. But look at that. That's already a lot of healthy pupa, isn't it? So it's starting to look like a good breeding project. I think this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 pupa already. 11 pupa already. Wow. And with some luck, I think I have like 11 more caterpillars. Maybe even more, I haven't counted. Let's place the pupa indoors for now. I will move them to another enclosure later. Eventually expect to see some beautiful moths. The moths will come out in about 3 weeks. So 3 weeks patience and we can see our first babies. Wow. Look, even more pupa. It's funny how they have this weird waxy coating. It's almost like a white powder coating them. Ladies and gentlemen, there is an announcement. Our first moth has come out of its pupa. Are you ready to see it? Prepare for your mind to be blown.
Wow. Here it is, ladies and gentlemen. The relict, or the forsaken. What a beautiful insect. It's funny because it's completely almost black and white. And there's not a single color on its body, yet I appreciate its beauty. I'm not one of the people who needs to have colors in order to appreciate beauty. I think these patterns, their contrasts, their shapes are absolutely incredible. Just look at that. This is why we breed Catucala, ladies and gentlemen. What an absolutely marvelous creature. Now we have to be very careful with these insects because Catucala are very good at escaping. Unlike Saturnid moths, these moths, they can fly away in one instant. Sometimes they don't even need to warm up very much. I guess they can fly at low temperatures. So we have to be careful. I cannot take it out of its enclosure. It's going to fly away in 1 second. But oh my god, it has a witchy look, right? Almost like its name, the Relict, makes it look more badass. But it really is like, I don't know. It's just some very mythical vibe to it. Wow.
Ladies and gentlemen, it has finally happened. We have our first relict, or the forsaken. Our first moth was born, and it's in this enclosure on my hand. Can you see it? But I have a problem. I cannot take this insect out of its enclosure, or it's going to fly away immediately. See, in my videos, I often take my Saturnid moths, the emperor moths, I take them outdoors. And that's because emperor moths are very docile. The chance of them randomly flying away and escaping is extremely small. But underwing moths, however, are very, 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 very different. I cannot film it outdoors. That's because when you try to touch them, see? They instantly they fly away like that. These moths are very, very, very active. So there's no way for me to make a close-up outdoors with a natural background, which I usually do in this type of video, because their behavior is just that they're just that ready to escape at any moment. But it's an absolute beauty. I guess I'll have to film it just inside its enclosure. Otherwise, it's just, see? Is gonna fly away. These insect Catucalas are very, very, very active moths. Wow, this moth is simply incredible. But what's even more incredible is that all of them can have different color forms. You will see later that when more moths start coming out of their pupa, these moths have different forms. These moths, by the way, can also live for a long time if you take care of them well, especially the females. Unlike silk moths, Catucalas can feed. They have a proboscis, which allows us to prolong their lifespan if we feed them well. This is my pupa box, by the way, a plastic container with paper tissue and actual towels. Make sure that the moths can climb up to the sides. This is very important. Uh-oh, ladies and gentlemen, I should take better care of these freaking pupa, because I forgot to put a lid on. So tomorrow I was looking out of the window. And look who's here in the corner. Can you see him? Aha! A new friend. Oopsie daisy. These moths are really annoying. Oh, there it goes. Oh, there you are. Will you please come with me? Oh God. Oh wow. So beautiful. I'm so happy. A new relict. It's so beautiful. Wow. Wow. This is the white form of Catocala relicta, also known as form clara, and it's absolutely beautiful. I am blown away. The dark contrast between the high twins with white forewings make the insect look really gothic and badass. On this channel we've seen a lot of moths with bright colors or camouflage, but this black and white, in my opinion, is something that I haven't seen before. Fun fact. The white form of this insect is pretty well camouflaged on the bark of birch trees. In fact, that's the main point of them being white. Birch tree, together with poplar tree, is one of the major host plants, and birch trees are also very prevalent in their habitat sometimes. So when landing on tree bark and there are sufficient birch trees around, the white form is actually effective camouflage.
Testing, testing. This is Bart Koppens in the Catocala relicta breeding video. And here behind me you have a really, 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 really big insect cage. Can you see it? It's really huge. And this is where I keep my Catocala in. Why? That's because these moths, if you take care of them properly, and I'm not joking, I'm not making this up, they can live for months. Yeah. Especially if you feed them very well. On my channel I breed a lot of silk moths, saturnids that only live for a few days, they have a very short lifespan. Underwing moths are the opposite, these can grow very old for a moth. I've had catocalas that can be 2 or 3 months old. If you really care for them, but it also depends on the species, some species don't live that long, others can. This is the first time I'm breeding relicta, I don't know how old they can get. But I think if I feed them well every day, maybe they can make it to over a month or two, that would be nice. So I'm just gonna keep them outdoors in this cage. They are from Canada, so the climate difference will not be that big. Canada is a temperate country, just like my country, the Netherlands. Holland, Holland, yes I know. So here I have some sugar water and a piece of cotton with honey on it. And the honey is drenched in water so they can drink it. There's a chance they're not going to be hungry. That's because... oh, there's a car. Moths, when they hatch from their pupa, they are born with what I call a full stomach. They are not very interested in food for the first few days after they are born. But let's see, the first moth should be like 2 days old already, 3 days old. Let's see what they will, if they will like it.
All right. So it does seem like one of them is hungry. Can you guys see it? It's feeding with the proboscis. What's interesting is in the wild these moths never ever visit flowers. Never. They are completely dependent on rotting fruits in autumn and sometimes tree sap. But not flowers, they never drink nectar. They're really mainly a fructivore, but I think they also drink like the sweet juices from bleeding trees, which can be sweet in some instances. Look at it drinking. Now for this species it's very important that you feed them once in a while. They have to be very well fed. Don't be greedy with the food, give them as much as they like. I'm filming this through a crack here in the cage because these moths can escape very fast. But yeah, feeding time for Catocala. Look at that, what a beauty. So Catocala are some of my favorite moths, to be honest. And I always wanted to make a life cycle video of them on my channel. I never had the time, but this year I have. And I promise you in the future there's going to be many more. This is the start of something new on my channel. These moths are gorgeous and very amazing. And there's like 300 species of them. It's insane. Like the diversity of Catocala is just absolutely insane. Oh wow, look at that. I love it. It satisfies me, you know? Wow. Also really cool in my opinion is the color difference. See, this one's four wings are basically white. Camouflage like tree bark. But this one is kind of more gray. See? I like that little bit of variation they have. There's definitely like several forms. And as you can see, some of them are appreciating the sugar water right now. Look at them drinking. Such different colors. I like the dimorphism that's going on here. It's very beautiful in my opinion.
This channel is demonetized, so usually I cannot afford fun stuff. But thanks to the generous donations of my fans, we have night vision. So let's activate the night vision camera to show you their activity at night. Thank you everyone who donated. Observing what your own moths are doing at night is not a privilege that many moth breeders have. Unless your name happens to be Bart Coppens, because I have night vision. Look at that. Middle of the night. It's pitch black. Man, this camera setting makes my eyes look so crazy. Yeah. Something weird got over me. Anyway, we have the infrared camera with us today to see how the moths are doing at night. Because they are being pretty active and pairing. Wow. So at night, these moths are actually pretty active. Which is pretty cool considering I usually breed moths that have lower levels of activity. At night, Catocala moths are typically very, very active. I like to compare Catocala moths with butterflies in some ways. They need a lot of a big enclosure and a lot of space and food. They are like the butterflies of the night with a high level of activity and a high desire to fly. Ladies and gentlemen, here is a pairing. Can you see how the males and females' abdomen are attached? That means that they are making love and soon will produce babies. Interestingly, pairings of Catocala are rarely documented or observed, so this is valuable footage. Even in captivity, it's not easy to film this without disturbing the animals. But the night camera helps, which is infrared, by the way. Ooh. The life of a moth breeder is never boring, because every day you can wake up and see new developments of your pets. Yeah, let's carefully remove the lid. And what we see here is, we see two new moths that have emerged. Two beautiful new white underwings. Oops, this one seems to have rubbed some scales off its back, but that's no problem, it will breed just fine. But inside the enclosure, we see even more new moths. Like here in the corner. So, I think I'll have to grab a cage to collect them for a bit. Good news, everyone! Good news! Are you a fan of my online web series Moth Cycles? Then I have good news, because I'm going to introduce a brand new feature to it. It's called the Wingspan Board. Each of the squares on this cutting board represent 1 centimeter. And I figured that a lot of people who are watching my videos, it's hard for them to figure out the skill that the insects are that you're watching on YouTube, you know? It's hard to imagine the scale or the size of an insect based off a video footage. So now we have an accurate way to measure them. And in each episode of Moth Cycles, that we raise a moth, from now on, I will add a segment where we check out its wingspans. That's cool, so let's get started. Alright, ladies and gentlemen, so how big are these moths really? Well, each of the squares in this image represent 1 centimeter. I can count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and maybe 2 halves. So let's say the animal is about 7 centimeters in size here. But I want one thing you guys should know, this is not the official wingspan, because the official way we measure wingspan is by looking at a mounted specimen which has pointed its forewings in an angle of 90 degrees. So, from wingtip to wingtip. So this animal in its natural position that it's sitting in right now is about, well, let's say it's about 7 centimeters. 6.5, 7 centimeters, something like that. It's not 100% accurate, I'm just looking at the board here. Clearly it is it's not the biggest moth that's ever been on my channel, but you know, it's not small. It's like a pretty decently sized animal. Now if I move the board, it's probably gonna fly away this instant. Oh no, this is a beautiful image. If you are interested in the size of these animals, now this is a very good video for you to get an idea of its size. Katokala moths can be quite big. They don't, most of the time they don't get as big as like the bigger silk moths. The Saturnids that we get on my channel very often, but like this is a respectable size, right? It's like a respectable size for an insect. Alright people, so here is some advice for aspiring underwing moth breeders. And this is, give them a very large enclosure like this one if you can. That's because Catocala moths are kind of like the butterflies of the night, in my opinion. They are the butterflies of the night in the sense that they can have a very long lifespan if you take care of them well. I think it's definitely possible for some of them to grow up to 2 months old. But in captivity that rarely happens because they are really active animals. And what happens if you put them in a small enclosure, they'll be flying around a lot and they'll be bumping into the walls if they do. And every time they collide with the walls, every tiny collision that they make is going to make a little bit of friction. And with every little bit of friction, their wings are going to deteriorate a little bit. So what happens is if you put this species in a tiny enclosure, because of their high level of activity, at night they can be flying sometimes for like hours, for hours. And when they are flying, they're just like bumping into the walls of their enclosure. And yeah, basically the more collisions they have, the shorter their lifespan because their wings are going to deteriorate faster. And this is a large enclosure, a very big enclosure. As you can see, you have many moths in them. During the day, these moths, they sleep. They are not supposed to be active during the day, but I'm just kind of teasing them so you can guys can see them. And then this cage is very big. It allows them to navigate the cage and more carefully and avoid bumping into the walls. So there's less collisions. So I think in this enclosure, they can live for a long time and I can enjoy them for a long time. Also for egg laying, it's important that they live very long. Because these species are—they're not the type of species that that dump their eggs all randomly in one day, like Saturnid moths, like the Saturnidae you see on my channel. These moths—they lay a few eggs per day, and if you make them last a long time, they're gonna lay more eggs. So it's about maximizing the lifespan to have more offspring. Now, this is how you can feed them. This is their feeding tray. And essentially, it's a bit of expired fruit. Here we have some plums and a banana. And the moment they start to rot, they start to decay and ferment, and the fermentation will attract the moths. They are very strongly attracted to the smell of alcohol, which, if you know, fermentation is yeast converting sugar into alcohols. So at night they will come to this fruit to feed. What's funny is I rarely observe them eating in captivity, but I know for a fact that they are eating, otherwise they wouldn't be alive. These underwing moths actually have a very short lifespan if you do not feed them. They will starve. They can starve in literal days if you don't give them food. And the fact that they are growing old confirms that they are eating. But I guess that they only spend a short amount of time feeding. Or maybe I haven't been able to observe it because it happens very late at night, who knows. But yeah, good stuff to use are pear, banana, plum, apricot. Whatever you use, make sure it is rich in juices. And also make sure that, you know, the moths can access this with their proboscis. These moths do not have a piercing proboscis that they can use to pierce the skin of fruit. So they really need the fruit to be rotting for the juices to become available to them. And what do we see here, ladies and gentlemen? This moth is sitting in the feeding tray on top of the fruit, if you can see it. Here's the bananas and the plums. But as you can see, it's eating. So here's the evidence that yes, indeed, at night these animals are automatically drawn to the fruit. And this one here is just having lunch, as we can see. Again, this is some unique footage of their behaviors at night. Can you see it? This proboscis is moving. These in the wild are strongly fructivores. What's interesting, Catocala moths, they never visit flowers, never ever. They are usually drawn to rotting fruits or sometimes tree sap. But they never drink nectar. And this is quite cool. Like observing how they eat at night. These moths are drinking from cotton wool soaked in honey water. If you soak cotton wool in honey water, they can use it to drink from for several days. They will be attracted to it automatically. Just make sure to replace it once in a while. This is what they drink from at night. And several nights later, there were more pairings. Wow, this one is dangling upside down, which moths often do if you've seen some of my other videos.
More evidence of the pairing of the white underwing moth. What's interesting is that pairings of this animal are rarely observed. That's because in the wild they have a very cryptic, a very hidden lifestyle. So, lots of biologists who study them fail to observe pairings in the wild. It's very rare. Even in captivity it can be hard to observe, but here we are, using our infrared technology. These moths have no clue that I'm here right now, filming them in the darkness. And as you can see, two of them in the corner are attached through their abdomens, which means that quite obviously here is a pairing going on. The trick to pairing them is to give them adequate space.
Catocala really, really prefer large enclosures, since they like to fly a lot and are long-lived. Feeding is also important. Unlike Saturnidae, they are not in a rush to breed because of a short lifespan. So make sure that you keep them alive for as long as possible and feed them regularly. Only then they will start mating after a while. The pairing does not seem to last all night, instead it tends to last for about 1 hour. But now I can be sure that some of the eggs that are going to be laid by the females are going to be fertile eggs, thankfully. Let's check back several weeks later.
It's finally time, ladies and gentlemen. Some of my moths are indeed starting to die. That's a shame. But they have to pass away eventually. Yeah, they live longer than most moths, but still they're far from immortal, sadly. Hey, I can see myself in the reflection of the container. Rest in peace, guys.
Many of them, however, are still alive. The older the moths become, the more their wings will deteriorate with old age. Eventually, they'll be almost completely unable to fly, unfortunately, such as old age for insects. The good news is, these live much longer than the other moths I have on my channel, so I was able to enjoy them for a longer time. It is hard to see for insect lovers, to see an old insect in this broken state, however. But it is part of the cycle of life. These moths love to lay their eggs in tiny crevices in their cage. The eggs are brown, and in the wild they are laid in the cracks of tree bark or on twigs. So let's collect some of these little eggs then. And with this huge amount of eggs, the life cycle is now completed. The eggs will not yet hatch this year, but they must hibernate first before turning them into the next generation of moths and caterpillars next spring. Females have an ovipositor, which is an egg-laying tube that they can force into crevices in order to deposit their eggs. This female here was starting to lay some eggs as I was filming. By the way, here's a tip. If your moths refuse to lay eggs, some species prefer to lay eggs on tree bark and don't like laying eggs on flat surfaces. Try giving them surfaces with a rough texture. It's all about texture. You can actually add some actual tree bark to their enclosure and they would love laying eggs on there. So many eggs. People, we collected so many fertile eggs of Catocala relicta. The forsaken. The relict, the white underwing. And to be honest with that, the video is almost over. So I hope you guys enjoyed the show. Before we finally end it, there's one thing I must do. I have to share some of these eggs with my fellow breeders. I will show you a clip of that. And after that, I guess that we are going to end the show because we had really a massive amount of eggs. And the life cycle is thus completed. Great!
What am I going to do with all those eggs? I'm going to sell some to customers, and here's how I send them. A coin case with eggs in it of moths. Can you see it? Like this. And in here are the eggs of the underwing moths. I'm going to post this to a customer who paid me to buy some eggs. And some people are going to be surprised to say, wow, Bart, you sell eggs of butterflies and moths online? I do sometimes in rare cases, but I do it very rarely because I have so many viewers and subscribers. When I post one item online, I'm gonna get like 100 inbox messages of people asking to buy them. I have like 10 times more demand than supply, and it often results in me having to disappoint people or turn them down. And from my experiences, this can make people bitter or hateful. Sometimes people even block me or unsubscribe and say, well, I don't know, they're just really entitled to get eggs from me for some reason. Although I'm just a YouTuber, I'm not a commercial breeder, I just like to make fun videos. But some people, they really like to blackmail me because they really want to have certain eggs of species, and it sucks. So that's why nowadays I offer eggs to patrons, people on my crowdfunding platform Patreon who subscribe to a certain tier are eligible for them. Only if it's legal. In many countries it's not legal to ship eggs of exotic species of butterflies and moths, so it's only in accordance with the law. But yeah, I do sell some of the eggs so other people can breed them. That's the end of the breeding project, ladies and gentlemen, but the video is not finished. Because in my special web series Moth Cycles, I like to give people a complete rundown of an insect that I breed so that we can learn about it. I think learning about the species we breed on YouTube is extremely important. I don't want this to be shallow entertainment like, oh, look at my cool species. No, I want you guys to understand our biology and conservation status too. So now let's start part 2, the discussion. You will like it. Let's start. Catocala species, also known as underwing moths. A highly fascinating and prevalent group of insects that gets surprisingly little attention. I don't really understand why they seem to be less popular than other moths. Perhaps it's because, well, I don't know to be honest. They are colorful, they are fascinating, and they are large. Most Catocala species have grey, brown or black forewings that are inconspicuous and enables them to camouflage themselves. But many species also have brightly colored and flashy hindwings that allows them to scare predators and confuse them with a bright flash of color when they fly or assume a threat pose. How many species of Catocala are there? It's hard to say because it depends on how you look at the taxonomic status of some of these species. However, there are definitely around 300 species of them. And that, my friends, is an amazing diversity for just one single genus of moths. Yes, that's right. There are over 300 species of underwing in the genus Catocala, and they come in various shapes, sizes, and colors. Impressive diversity, don't you think? Let me show you some cool species first to get you excited, such as this amazing Catocala nivea, which is found in Japan and Taiwan, has a really spooky, ghostly appearance. Look at these voodoo markings, a really cool one for Halloween. They are hard to get, but with some crowdfunding, we could get them on my channel someday as well. How about these incredible Catocala ultronia with blood red hindwings? It is found in most of eastern North America, south to Florida and Texas. It ranges west across the southern parts of Canada to the extreme southeast of British Columbia. A lot of Catocala species have incredibly brightly colored hindwings, such as this one. Absolutely beautiful. Some of them even have blue underwings, such as Catocala fraxini, the blue underwing, a big species from northern and central Europe, Russia, Korea, Japan, Turkey and the UK.
It's also found in my own country, the Netherlands, although it is quite rare where I live. Yellow underwings? You've got it! Red, pink, blue, yellow, white. The variety of color you can see in different Catocala species is incredible. Are you yet convinced that underwing moths are cool? You should be. I challenge you to breed one. Some of them don't have colored hindwings at all. They can also be plain black or gray, which is also beautiful in its own respect. Such as this Catocala apiona right here. A number of species have plain black or plain white hindwings instead of the colorful arrangement you will see in others. This one is from Canada and the United States. Underwing moths from the genus Catocala have a sweet tooth, and one of their favorite foods is rotting or fermenting fruits. They use their long proboscis to drink the juices from damaged, decomposing or fallen fruits. They mainly do this at night in the darkness, since they are mainly nocturnal. However, in rare occasions, and perhaps if the moths are desperately hungry or thirsty, they are also observed feeding in daytime. Although daytime activity is generally rare for these nocturnal animals, it still happens sometimes. Among their favorites are fruits such as plums, pears, cherries, and apples. They are attracted by the smell of alcohol, which forms when yeast break down sugar and convert it into alcohol during fermentation. Since alcohol is highly volatile, they can smell it easily with their sensitive antennae. One of the favorite food sources of underwing moths is tree sap. Tree sap is high in sugar and minerals, and some trees, when they are damaged, broken or infected, can start bleeding sap. This attracts moths such as Catocala species that are happy to drink from the source. In particular, they enjoy sap from oak trees, birch trees, and several types of fruit trees such as apple or pear. Do underwing moths visit flowers? No, not really, but also, actually, yes, they do. But this is generally very, very rare. Generally speaking, Catocala moths avoid flowers because they vastly prefer non-nectar food sources. Perhaps them visiting flowers is an act of desperation, if fruits or tree sap are perhaps hardly available. But they don't really seem to like flower nectar at all. Observations of these moths on flowers are thus very limited and somewhat rare, but surprisingly they do exist. The caterpillars of Catocalas can be big but are often rarely found in nature because they are masters in camouflage. Most caterpillars are grey, brown or even greenish and will press themselves flat against the surface such as tree bark, twigs but also lichens. And when they do this, they can effectively disappear into the background. The caterpillars mostly feed at night in the tree canopies. They camouflage during the day and start eating in the darkness. Although fully grown larvae are more often seen during the day too, both during day and night, I suppose. Because they tend to live high up in the vegetation and have incredible camouflage, people don't really spot them very often, except for when they leave the host plant in order to make a cocoon. The underside of the caterpillars, interestingly, can have noticeable colors. Some species even have red bellies. Why? When the caterpillars are disturbed, their defense mechanism is to flip themselves on their back, make twitching or rolling movements, sometimes even flipping themselves over several times. And a display of color may intimidate predators. The eggs of almost every species of Catocala, and perhaps literally every species, must hibernate before they emerge. In fact, I've read about the life history of dozens of species, and all of them so far that I found had one brood per year. So it's safe to say that most, if not all, Catocala moths are single brooded and hibernate as eggs. Eggs are generally laid on tree bark and twigs of the respective host plant and spend the winter under lower temperatures. In spring, after temperatures rise again, the rise in warmth will trigger them to come out of their eggs. Generally speaking, Catocala species inhabit the whole Arctic realm. Moths are found in almost every temperate whole Arctic region of the world, including Russia, temperate Asia, such as Japan and Korea, and also Europe, North America, Canada, the rest of the United States, but also North Africa and the Middle East. Please note that this map shows the whole Arctic realm and not a perfect distribution of Catocala worldwide, although there is a major overlap between both ranges. The range will of course not overlap precisely everywhere. Let's talk about this species today, the white underwing, also known as the relict or the forsaken. Wow, such edgy names. Personally, I know them by the name Catocala relicta, described in 1857. The species we raised together today in this very YouTube video. Should I believe the records online, then we can assume this species lives in southern Canada, from Newfoundland to Vancouver Island, south to Missouri and Arizona. A wide distribution from the east coast to the west coast, it seems. Several host plants are recorded in literature, although I haven't tried all of them myself in captivity to confirm them. But reportedly, caterpillars can eat populus or poplar tree and aspens, but also salix or several kinds of willow, betula or birch trees, quercus or oak trees, and caria or hickories. In favorite in particular, they seem to prefer poplar tree a lot. This species survives in a habitat type called northern deciduous forest. This makes sense considering the plants the caterpillars prefer to eat are trees. Truly, for the most part, it is considered a forest species, and conserving the health and the abundance of forest is very important for their conservation. There appear to be three basic forms of this species, form Phrynia, form Relicta, and form Clara. Or the gray form, the intermediate form, and the white form. In this video, from one batch of eggs, I seem to have raised both the intermediate and the white form. The dark form, Phrynia, was absent in my rearing, however. The white form of this species is perhaps truly the most remarkable. While being white may seem conspicuous, the opposite is true. The moths are camouflaged excellently on the bark of birch tree in particular. Keep in mind that they rest during the day with their hind wings concealed, not exposed like they are in these pictures. In fact, they blend in almost perfectly on birch trees. The darker forms blend in better on other types of trees, such as poplar tree. The eggs are laid as soon as the adults are out. The eggs, however, do not hatch until the next spring, which should be around April or March if the first sunny days arrive. The species is univolting, which means they have one brood a year. Caterpillars then develop, typically from spring until July, and pupate, bringing on a new generation of moths from July to October. If you want to attract these moths to your garden to observe them yourself, it's possible. These moths, however, are rarely attracted to artificial light. A better method to study them is to mix mashed banana, plum or other fruits with beer or wine, add sugar, heat it, and smear the syrup on trees. It's important that it contains both alcohol and sugar, and preferably some type of fruit. I even have a special video on my YouTube channel that shows you how to do this in great detail. It's called Cooking for Moths. Check it out if you want to. Thank you for watching, ladies and gentlemen. I love every single all of you. The people who watch this channel are the people that help me achieve my dreams. This video cost me a lot of time and energy to produce and has been in production for 7 months' time. I hope you appreciate my effort, my labor, and my hard work. Before we move on, I still have some important things to say before the video is over. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope that you enjoyed watching the show. This particular video I spend a lot of time on, filming how these moths grow up from egg to moth, breeding them, documenting the pairings. Everything was a piece of work that lasted for months. So yeah, my YouTube channel takes a lot of effort because I make these really long, elaborate videos. I give a complete rundown of a species, and this can take a lot of patience, you know. You have to film the entire life cycle of an animal in captivity while taking care of them successfully. capturing all the events, editing, writing a script. And for me, this is really hard to do. And I'm going to be honest, continuing to do this in the future could be difficult for me. That's because my YouTube channel is demonetized by YouTube. Why? Well, they refused to tell me. Around 2008, I think, 2018, YouTube sent me an email that my channel is demonetized by YouTube. Well, what does that mean? Here's the thing, normally YouTubers, when they have like more than 1,000 subscribers and 4,000 hours of watch time, they can become a part of the YouTube Partner Program. And when you become part of the YouTube Partner Program, it means ads are going to be playing on your videos, advertisements. And when people click on these advertisements, you'll earn a few cents. Now, if you get a lot of views, these few cents will add up. And that's how big content creators and YouTubers can fund their channel. They can make money with their channel. They can grow a business with their channel. And it sustains their growth. Sadly to me, however, I'm stuck. Because YouTube demonetized my channel and they refused to tell me why. Now, why am I saying this? Because to overcome this obstacle, my channel has crowdfunding. This channel is 100% paid for by the donations of my generous viewers. It is 100% crowdfunded. I have a crowdfunding platform that's called Patreon, where you can buy a subscription to my channel. Even as little as $1 helps a lot. There's things such as Ko-Fi, PayPal, LiberaPay. You can go into the description of my video, and under there you'll find a lot of links and websites that I've made that will help me support this channel. Sorry, I have the hiccups. I had a lot of soda. Anyway, yeah. So if you like the show, consider donating to it. Consider contributing to it financially, because it's the only way my channel can survive. I am entirely dependent on the tips and donations of my fans and my viewers and my subscribers. And therefore, I am forced as a YouTuber to beg on the internet. I'm forced to beg to strangers because it's my only option. There's no company sponsoring me. YouTube is not helping me. I'm all alone. And it's only the generous contributions of my viewers, people like you right now, who tip and donate, that allow me to continue to do this. So, sorry for asking, I know it sounds a bit cringy, because I don't like doing it, even after all these years. Asking strangers on the internet for money, it still feels pretty bad, it makes me kind of insecure. But I have no other option, really. And without the backbone of support that some of my loyal subscribers are giving me, I would not be making these videos, it would be impossible. This is so much time, so much effort I have to put into these videos. And I'm not here to make money or become rich, but it's impossible to entertain 20,000 people for free and have high-grade equipment and spend months of work basically on one video that's not going to get a lot of views because moths are not that popular. Yeah, but there is some good news. Recently, my channel found a serious investor. His name is Rob. That's all I can say. I can reveal Rob is from the United States. I mentioned him in my videos before. Not only is he a sponsor of my channel, I see him as a friend too. He has been of great help to me. He really believes in the mission of my channel. I've talked to Rob, and for me, what I find interesting is he gets what I do. I feel like Rob, he understands exactly what I'm trying to get at with this channel. And even without me having to explain to him what it is that I want to achieve, it's like he knows. And he supports it. Rob sent me in the early this year an incredible donation. In fact, it was enough to sustain my YouTube channel work full time for several months. That's how generous it was.
Therefore, I do also want to give Rob a shout out. I give all my patrons a shout out, but first we give Rob a special shout out. We have the Rob t-shirt, yeah! Thank you, Rob, the myth, the man, the legend. That's right. So let's light some sparkles to celebrate this fact. Hopefully I'm not going to set myself on fire. Or hopefully I am, maybe. No, I'm not that self-hating. Oh, really? Come on. Come on, please catch fire for me. Come on, you can do it. Come on, come on, please, please. Yes, 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 yes. Oh, dear Lord, this is just so frustrating. I'm bad at this. I'll admit it. I am bad at this. So, spontaneous combustion attempt number 2. That's not that spontaneous. Have to keep it away from my eyes. Because these sparkles are sometimes... Seriously? Rob, I'm sorry for the delay. I'm clumsy with matches, I suppose, and it's cold and it's windy. Let's try with 2 at the same time. Right. Right. Are you for real? Are you for real? Damn it. Okay. I'm going to try again. Doesn't matter. My whole life is trial and error. In case you guys didn't know, this sums up my life, really. Doesn't matter how many times I fail, I keep trying. That's how I've convinced over 20,000 people on YouTube that I'm not a total loser. Which I am. God. Seriously? Am I going to waste all my matches on this? Oh, come on, please, wind. Don't extinguish. Ah! Okay. We keep going. We keep going. This doesn't matter. Please, 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 I beg you. Yes. Is it happening? Yes, yes. We did it. Let's light the other sparkles too. Rob, if you're watching this, thank you so much. Ooh, they're bright. Rob, if you are watching this, thank you so much. You made a huge difference for my YouTube channel and for my life. We are going to achieve big things on this channel soon. It's going to change dramatically. I have big things in store for 2022. It's the incredible support of people like you that enable me to do what I love. It's also the incredible support of all my other fans that allow me to do what I love as well. You guys are not forgotten. And if this channel ever grows really, really, really big, I will not forget about all of you that helped me get there along the way. But for now, I am still a small YouTuber with a decent amount of support for my channel size. But the truth is, the channel just needs to grow a little bit bigger. It just has to be a little bit bigger. Wow. Let's light another sparkle, because I'm in a good mood, folks. Ooh, these are bright. My eyes hurt if I look at them. It's like staring into the sun, bro. Yay! Thanks, Rob! Being a YouTuber is weird, man. Whoa! Crazy. I'm a pyromaniac now. Don't play with fire, kids! Inspirational message of the day. Fire can ruin your life, but my life is already ruined, so don't worry, I'm safe, huh? Whew. So for next year we have some incredible things in store. I'm not going to do the big reveal yet, some people behind the scenes know. But let's just say that I'm going to do real research, somewhere in a rainforest. And it will involve conservation of insects and conservation of wildlife and documenting wildlife for YouTube too. It's going to be exciting. But I'm not going to give out all the details yet. Not just yet. You guys will have to be patient and follow my channel and see what happens next. But let's just say we are taking this stuff to the next level. Ooh, these two are hot. Let's put them here in the away. So yeah, thank you, Rob. Rob was kind enough to provide a budget for dozens of videos this year. And it was very generous of him. So for me, it's important to give him at least somewhat of a shout out. It's the least that I can do in return, right? Of course, my other way to repay my gratitude is to make entertaining videos, because that's what you guys wanted in the first place, right? Entertainment. That's what this business is about. It is educational entertainment. I entertain people. So yeah, it's a win-win situation. You guys are entertained. I am entertained. I get to do what I love. I raise awareness for animals and their conservation. Everybody wins in the end. Oi, man. Okay. Now I'm really out of things to say. So let's just wait for this thing to burn out. If you like the channel, consider donating. Because without donations, I can't do shit. YouTube demonetized me, and I spent months of work on videos like these, forcing me to beg to the extreme to fund this operation. Hey, of course, if you don't contribute, you are no less of a viewer. I understand not everybody is willing or able to. It's difficult financial times. There's a recession. There's a pandemic. Take it easy. This channel is free education also for people who are not willing or able, because I like providing free information. I really believe strongly in freely accessible information, especially when it comes to endangered, unusual or rare animals, or otherwise obscure animals that people don't care about in the first place. So yeah, see y'all later. Bye bye.